And so when I blow up and I'm in a sickle state, I get 4 kilos per Chinese joint. Expect the eye. Venus sickle spot. Off the eye. That's what the choice of bar.
Yeah.
ambulance compliance about 30 bucks a fee.
Thank you.
So I can apply that place. There's a body, there's a surface landing on the rock, while Shock 2 is going up. There's something out of the family and I got body by straight. So this is our way. So, of course, you will expect that. These are the things.
So basically, when you're in bed, you're writing some PN, and then you have to use a formula on the connected component.
some trouble, right? That's what you're saying. But you know, you have this cardio position and the top surface section of that ankle divisor depends only on the volume on the upper body plate. So you get all of these plus this effective. It's really effective. That's an embedded, yeah. Okay, so I think I'll stop there. Construct equivariant homology from chain level data. singular chains on X with singular chains on ES1. Okay, but let me point out that singular chains on ES1, since S1 acts freely, singular chains on ES1 is in fact free chains of S1 module. And ES1's contractible, the map between ES1 and point, you know, induces a standard function of C star S1 modules from this to C star point. So this is the free version of C star point, right? Okay, all of which is to say that you can think of this in a more regular fashion as a derived tensor. Resolution and take the tensor product, or if you want, the equivalent of ES1. And now I'm just using K instead of C star point. Okay, so I started with the space with S1 action. From that, I can extract the module of the chains on S1. And that's enough to apply the vector. Okay. And when we need this, well, we're going to study context where there aren't geometric S1 actions. And so sometimes we'll want to extract the module this way.
Okay.
assuming that the metrics also, hit their under representation, which is one of the two lies that we've told so far. Now, maybe now's the right time to, well, okay, so let me start with a fake lemma and then just say why this is not right. But, okay, so the claim, this is actually a well-defined operation. Okay, so the claim is that still, we have a chain map. Okay. And it should get a strict as one structure. If things could work out the way I used to do, okay, but there's the problem. Even in Morse theory, sometimes there's a problem, I think, which is that, of course, if you have a space with an action, maybe Morse theory is okay, but here you sort of, let me just say, promise. Okay, so it cannot, in reality, guarantee that either the action function for which we're really taking the homology, okay, so in general, we, to actually get a non-degenerate critical point, a non-degenerate modulus space, we have to consider S1-dependent, J and H. Orbiting H, come in, S1-dependent, and then final. So plus orbits are degenerate, since they're not isolated critical points, we break S1 symmetry. That's not even the first complex of H plus some. S1-dependent okay, and similarly, we really need some S1-dependent operation. Okay, all this is to say that we get a chain map, but it doesn't split into zero. But, well, it's a chain map, and you can show that the homology splits into zero. So in particular, delta D plus D delta, and this, another thing to say in this transfer ends up involving all these operators anyway. Yeah, so like a something that's twice as strong. That's right. Yes.
Actually, my top title has had a fixed wheel.
Thank you.
So I select the cohomology as a Hamilton cohomology for a particular class of Hamiltons. The radical chi category is the chi category for a particular class of Hamiltons, allowing on the Hamilton units. I think that's the most important thing to say. But, you know, a lot of what I'm going to say applies in the compact category here. So I'm trying to get that point and just focusing on the fact that these are defined using, you know, closed equations for some Hamiltons. We can talk about whether the Hamilton is a large growth Hamilton in particular. This is something on the RAM category.
Thank you.
subsequent chain of words has a start point. And so we specify the start point of our orbit by saying
thank you.
some more flavor, a little more flavor. I want to talk about two reduct groups, the limit group and GLN. So according to these two groups, I will have two pictures. This is GLN C. I will have these three hollow spaces with the letter N and the letter M. Now, depending on the flavor, you have three cohomologies that are natural. One is the singular cohomology, what some people call singular cohomology, bent cohomology. So the small space will correspond to this interpretation. On a CVD manifold, you have differential forms. So here we will be the Dirac interpretation. And on this holomorphic compact manifold, you have the splitting of the holomorphic forms in their double pieces, the holomorphic and unholomorphic part. So here there will be a double modular space, and the same here, B, D, R, and D, O. Now, the first part of the talk is the discussion of this object culminating in the non-abelian Hodge theorem, which is stating that there is a natural diffeomorphism between the first and third. It's a natural diffeomorphism between all three of them, but I will focus on this in this talk. So, it's a natural diffeomorphism. I put R just to remind myself that these are complex manifolds, but this is a diffeomorphism that is neither holomorphic nor anthelomorphic, so it's truly big in this sense. Now, given this, this is the statement of the non-abelian Hodge theorem, and given this isomorphism in cohomology, there is an isomorphism in cohomology. And the second part of the talk introduces further structure of these cohomorphisms in the form of some subspaces, some filtration into subspaces, which on this side I will denote by WB. W stands for weight, and in this side we will have a different filtration that I call PDOL, which stands for perverse layering. I will try to explain both of them. Now they define and depend on the complex structures here, which are different. So the statement for the second part of the talk is that under these isomorphisms they correspond to each other at the GL. By the gauge, but that boils down to taking just the anthelomorphic forms.
says here, these three things are connected. Because I can start with my form. And take the exponential of the integral over a molar sum. And it gives me a representation. Or I can take the anthropomorphic part of the stored form. And then the nice thing is that these are isomorphisms. In fact, you can view this as a Adéron theorem with denominators. You can view this as the Hodge theorem with denominators, the denominator being the left. Now this is an isomorphism of real Lie-groups. And the feature here with respect to the first two, the third one is also complex. So by Hodge theory, this is a full lattice, and this is a complex torus. However, this is a complex manifold in a natural way, but these are not complex manifold in a natural way, so it doesn't make sense to ask whether the maps are homomorphic. Now in fact, this is a famous object, it's called the Picard torus. But because even if this has no torus, there is a top-down natural joint, but this point is irresistible to say that this torus, which is called Picard, is also naturally isomorphic to a torus, which is called the Jacobian torus. And this is part of a beautiful story, because if you take integration on the Riemann surface, you can set up an isomorphism between the anthropomorphic form and the dual anthropomorphic form, and then you divide by the lattice given by integrating along the multi-cycle. Then this is the same. Naturally. Not the same, but naturally the same. And this is the Jacobian torus. And this is the modern geometric object that underlies the other Jacobian torus. So even if you have no bearing of the torus, it's the same. Okay, so this is the story for U1. So now what is the story for GL1? Well, you just take P into GL1. Again, you divide by GL1, which is abelian. Here you take unconstrained flat connections, modulo gauge, and then here you take, and this is a bit tricky, but anyway, let me say it. You take the holomorphic structure, take pairs, holomorphic structure and differential holomorphic form. I'm not going to try to explain why this is natural, but I'll give an explicit map between the three spaces, and I'll try to say the key word that allows you to define a map here to here. Now, the map here to here is the obvious map. You take the form and you integrate to the holomorphic of connection. This is the holomorphic. And here is the existence and essentially the existence of the so-called harmonic metric for connection. Let me just say this. Before we took our imaginary form and we took the anthropomorphic part. Here, you take a form, and you would say, okay, let me take this, but that doesn't work. I cannot take the anthropomorphic part and expect to have an actual construction. You have to use this guy to produce a harmonic representative of something associated with this. So that's a subtle point, and I will say anything more about this. But then, when you do all the calculations as above, here you get H1 Dirac, the coefficients in C, modeled by integral lattice. Here you get H1B of X with coefficients in C star. And here you get the dual space of anthropomorphic forms divided by the integral lattice times the holomorphic forms. There's an actual way to see this. I mean, no. Once you do this, you do the calculation, you can see that it works like this. You take an anthropomorphic form, you take a holomorphic form, and then the map in this direction, I write it because I want to comment upon it, is this. Maybe the plus and minuses are mixed up, but it doesn't matter. The point is that this is clearly not holomorphic, and it's clearly not anthropomorphic, so it's clearly mixed. There's no hope. So what you have here is three complex Lie groups with a biomorphism between the first two and an R isomorphism between the second and third. Okay, so these are the spaces in rank 1. I denote it by N. These are the spaces that in rank 1, but unconstrained by the just the GL1 I call it. And then an angle hole. Okay, so what's the story in bigger rank? So the story in rank 2 or rank 1, not sorry, rank 2 or higher. Now this is where the story actually becomes very interesting, because this picture is completely generalized by the highly untrivial way. So the first object was defined by Lamport. And it's the modular space, the reference space of back bundles. Modulo holomorphic back bundles. Modulo isomorphisms. Now basically, the thing that one has to mention, one has to take stable holomorphic back bundles. So I'm not going to define what stable means, but I actually can use the word of the person who invented them when he actually introduced them to the world in his ICM talk. Lamport said, well, let's think about this as follows. Introduce a certain notion of positivity on the back bundle, which he called stability. He called slope. And then you call the vector bundle stable if A is a bundle
is also bad. And you don't need